I'm not feeling it at all today, right now. It's like, wow. I had a dream last night of a tremendous storm on the horizon, just with intense, ferocious, vicious lightning strikes. And I realized, hey, you know, it's almost here. It is almost here. That storm is coming. And all I can think of is outrun the storm, go in the opposite direction. But how to do that? You're very sluggish right now. There's no question that I said in July, that would be the critical month. July is a critical month, and we're feeling it. We're feeling it right now. Just try and move in the outrun the storm. Just try, and you'll feel like almost immobilized. Very sluggish. I can hardly walk today. Can't even play a round of golf. It's a warm day here in the Bay Area. Beautiful breeze. And yet the storm is approaching on the subtle level. If you were able to look on the subtle level, which is much more accurate than what our eyes are seeing. What our eyes are seeing is a kind of blindness, really. Sometimes when we sleep, we're seeing on the more subtle levels, and what's actually happening is depicted in like a dream. And on that subtle level, the storm is coming. It is a monster. That's the Armageddon storm, is what I call it. Full of lightning flashes, bolts of lightning, just hitting the earth just ferociously. And that storm has been building for a long, long time. I've been watching it build on the subtle levels. If you could look at this world on the subtle levels, you would see the darkest, blackest, most intense thunderstorm imaginable, just with the intensity built and the charge built up so much that this just like can produce unlimited lightning. Very combative, very intense, and so I want to, go in the other direction, outrun the storm, not get hit by it. That's the idea. That is the idea. And so we can pray for that. We can focus on that. We don't want to hang around for this storm to get here. No way. So the focus continues to be how to outrun this storm. What does it take? What kind of focus does it take? It takes a clarity, a resolve, a realization. I believe I have what it takes to do that, but I can tell you right now, it doesn't seem to be in focus. It doesn't seem to be in focus. So let's just sit with that for a minute. Maybe you're feeling also like sluggish and say, oh, you know what? I think I'm going to get clobbered. The world's going to clobber us. That's kind of how, I think that's pretty much the way everybody's feeling right now. There's a somber feeling, I mean, that Colorado thing was a very symbolic thing. I mean, that's not a joke. Well, yeah. It's not a joke. It's meant to pull everybody into a very somber mood. And we cannot allow that. We cannot combat it through frivolous amusement either, We can't go to some chili heads channel and watch them, melt under the heat of a 2 million Scoville units or something. I mean, that's not going to get the job done. That's amusement. That's frivolous amusement. That is kind of a reaction formation to a feeling of doom. The purpose about talking about doom is to avoid it. Is to outrun it, go in the opposite direction, get free of it. That's the purpose. It's not to make us feel like we're doomed. Just the opposite. It's to make us feel like we can see it coming, And we can't outrun it, therefore. It's like I see the storm coming. I've seen it. I know it. And so I can say, hey, you know, wait, there's a highway. I'm on the highway. There is a road that goes away from the direction the storm is coming. Let's take that road. And maybe we don't know what's down that road. But I tell you, there's blue skies. The road just goes in the direction of blue skies, which can't be a bad thing. We certainly don't want to drive on the road into the storm. And we certainly don't want to just stay parked, which is a feeling of futility. Just watch it come towards us, you know, which is what most of the world will do. And as that storm comes towards us, at those who are just sitting there, sitting ducks, what is their reaction to this going to be? They are going to get into a frivolous mood. That is a reaction formation. You know, it's like they'll say, hey, everybody, let's throw a fashion show. Let's get goofy. Let's get really goofy. Let's start drinking and doing drugs and have a Bacchanalian time. Let's get really campy and goofy, and that mood is going to happen. It's been building up. That mood has been building in the world as a reaction formation, which is to basically is a defense mechanism for those. It's not about outrunning the storm at all. It's about just being a sitting duck. And how can you, as the storm comes upon you, how can you just kind of try and stay in a, you know, good mood? Yeah. Let's eat, drink, and be merry type of situation. It's like on the Titanic. I think those people, you know, subconsciously they knew they're about ready to sink. And so they, you know, what do? Dance faster. Play the music. Maestro, play a lively tune. Let's dance a little faster. Let's be a little gayer. Let's be a little livelier. Let's be drink a little more. And let's get real high and on a frivolous amusement and all this stuff. So there is a massive, massive buildup of the experts of frivolity and amusement in this world to act like a drug. It's kind of like a drug. People, what are they going to do? They're going to drug themselves some way. But what we're going to do is we're going to outrun it. We're going to outrun the storm. Got to shake off this lethargy. We're not going to get into gaiety and amusements and frivolity and all that stuff. Awesome. Very great. Because your intention to outrun it, that's the engine that drives the vehicle. Because we're entitled to outrun it. We're entitled to live under the laws of that God created, the laws of reality. Existence is an insane asylum. We can sidestep it. We're entitled to sidestep it. We're entitled to sanity. We're entitled to truth. We're entitled to freedom. We're entitled to safety. We're entitled to all this. Now, even in a dream, when the big bad storm comes in a dream, we're still entitled to outrun that storm. Of course. You know, you can feel how bad it is do you feel, you know, feisty, spiritually feisty? You feel on point, you know. Like a dog that's you know, full of vim and vigor and just, you know, vibrating like full on ready for spiritual inquiry and truth. Or do you feel sluggish and say, oh man, I can hardly do it. I'm today very sluggish. I tried to watch a satsang from a teacher, and I couldn't even concentrate on at all. I said, wow, that is incredible. We lost that feistiness. That's what this coming storm is doing. It's going to knock us all out. It's going to start throwing some knockout blows. As I told you, look out for July. That's when it's going to start. And I had an experience of multidimensionality on July 5th. That's the positive, you know, saying, hey, go in this direction. And now, you know, the negative is going to jump up and start biting the world. The darkness is going to start slinging its lightning bolts everywhere. And first and foremost is you have to have that feistiness, you know, which before I posted this video, I worked on about 6 videos, and I had to delete them because I couldn't even talk. I had nothing. So I said, hey, I can't post this. This isn't helping anyone. And above and beyond anything that is said as far as the consciousness, the awareness, the oneness, the nothingness, the blah, 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 blah. Above and beyond any of that, you have to have this feistiness. You have to have it, okay? You can't just be sitting there like, I'm doomed. Here comes the storm. I'm going to be annihilated, you know. How can I feel good about this? I'm trapped. I got no energy. I can't do anything. Have to come, snap out of that. So, just the conveyance here of the intensity, the feistiness, you know, yes, we can outrun it. That is numero uno. That is el primero. Number one. That's what has to be conveyed. And the ones that can convey that at this time are the ones that can drive the engine, that can help. And above and beyond any, you know, technical clarifications, if that drive isn't there, those clarifications aren't going to do any good. They're not going to do any good. I tell you, that they're trying to sink our spirits. This is something that we foresaw, knew it was coming, and now it's here. So it's, you know, the storm is hitting, and we have to outrun the storm. As it were, that's a metaphor. But it's fine to, you know, think that way. That's a good way to get fired up. Let's get fired up. It's almost like kind of a paralysis, you know, that we're getting hit with. This, you know, in dreams, sometimes you have this terrible situation moving towards you, and you feel like you're paralyzed. You can't run away. You can't move. It's like that. It's like that. Wow. Let's get fired up. Very difficult at this time, but it's doable. We have to do it. It's just a simple, you know, no. Just say no to the magic show. No to the insistence, the demands that we pay attention to this magic show. This is the big production coming. The big storm. The Armageddon storm is coming. And is demanding attention. It's an attention getter. And who are we, you know, to say, brush it aside? Well, I'll tell you what. We will brush it aside. It's like this big movie is coming, and everybody's expected to go to the movie theaters and watch it. And we say, no, we're not going to that theater. We're not going in there. We are not going in that movie theater. Don't watch it, so to speak, metaphorically speaking. The big show, you know, is here, and all the advertisements, all the pros, and there's all these cheerleaders, you know, going, and they're all cheerleading, and, you know, and they watch this movie, watch the movie, here it comes. You gotta watch it. If it gets too dark for you, look, here's some cheerleaders to brighten your day, and they're passing out drinks and passing out party favors, and, you know, and we're sitting there in our seat saying, you know what, something tells me I don't want to keep sitting in this seat. I want to get out of here. And we feel that way, and the more you feel that way, the skimpier the costumes get. The cheerleaders' costumes get skimpier and skimpier and skimpier, right? And they say, hey, if you leave now, you're gonna miss it, and they're probably gonna take it all off, so to speak, literally, figuratively, in every which way. Those are those whose job it is to keep us rooted to our seat. There's a ton of those people functioning that way in this world. Fast industry designed simply to keep us in our seat as the Armageddon storm of fear and the lightning comes upon the screen, and it's designed to just freak us out entirely. But of course, anyone in their right mind will see this coming. They'll get out. But again, on the stage, there are all these cheerleaders, all these glossy looking cheerleaders, and they're trying to, you know, say, look at us, look at us, look at us, you know. Look at this. This is so sexy, so beautiful, so glamorous. Wow, so cool. How can you leave the theater? How can you leave? You know, if things get too bad, just keep looking at us. Well, of course, you stay, and then the storm gets worse and worse and worse. What's on the screen becomes more and more terrifying. You become terrified. Meaning, what is terra? Means earth, doesn't it? Means you feel your earth bound. There's a ritual of appealing to magic. And what you're doing is you're trying to offer yourself up as a sacrificial victim to forgetfulness, to magic, to the darkness, to death, all that. Thinking that out of that will arise a redemptive power, a power that will elevate you to prime creator status. It's appeal to magic. It's a big appeal. It's a big song and dance right now. All the different players are here designed to keep us in our seats. But I'm saying, get up out of your seat. Walk out of the theater. This whole Colorado thing was a metaphor, really. Tragedy and a metaphor and an attention getter and an awakener. And, you know, let's say there's some people in that theater, for instance, that felt something's, you know, I got a uneasy feeling, and you know, I don't want to watch this movie. It feels dark to me. It feels sinister. I don't want to watch it. I want to get out and leave. And they leave. They leave. You see, or they someone feels they don't want to go to that movie. They don't feel right about it. They don't go. All right. See, that's following your intuition. Same thing with the world. See, I don't want to stay here. Someone feels I don't want to stay here. This world doesn't feel right to me. It feels sinister. I don't want to stay here. I want to relocate. I want to be translated into relocation. But, you know, very few will do that. It's so intimidating. I've gone to a movie theater before, and I suddenly felt like I don't want to watch this movie. I don't want to be here. And I got up and left. And It's difficult because people think you're weird. Like, if you pay your money, you're there, you know, in a nice seat and this, wow, this big movie, you know. And actually, that was the last time I ever went to a movie. That was like at least 8 years ago. Never been to a movie since. I hadn't been to a movie in decades before that. And I decided I'm going to try one more. And suddenly I realized, wow, no. This whole scene is not right. Don't get transfixed in your seat. Don't get terrified. Don't get terraformed. Don't get earthbound. Your spirit, you're free. You're not even a form. You're not even in matter at all. This is all a dream. Don't let the dream transfix you, terraform you, terrify you. Forget it. You don't have to. You don't have to. You got the will. You got the truth. You have what it takes. At all times, in all situations. And of course, though, we forget. We forget all our clarity. So what do you do there? All you've got is that this inner core of like feistiness of saying, No, you don't get into some intellectual discussion about it. Just say, no, I'm not going with this. This is not it. Sacrifice doesn't work. This whole thing of existence is all rotten. Completely. Always has been, always will be. It's wrong. It's an attempt to establish a new creation, a new reality, a new prime creator. And it's attempting to do this through appealing to magic, and these appeals to magic are sacrificial, can be very sacrificial. And it's saying, let's everybody together forget what we are. Let's all sacrifice any remaining vestige or remembrance of what we are. Why do you think these movies are so terrifying, so dark, so full of violence, etc.? Why do everybody go to them? Because they're trying collectively to forget who they are. Do they say, this is, you know, maybe we can, by watching this horrible stuff, we can all completely forget what we are. And then magic will be satisfied, you know. It's like the story of Jesus coming into the world, and the people decided, let's all just kill him. Let's all crucify him and offer this crucifixion up to magic. And then this imaginary God that we're believing in will be so pleased that we chose this magic over reality. We chose lies over truth. We chose death over life. We'll be so pleased that this imaginary God will finally release the power to make us prime creators. Let's go on this, because this gets right to the root of it. I know, well, we need to be feisty, we need to get going here. So I can tell you the whole crucifixion thing, I can explain it to you, what happened. Basically, whether it happened or not, or whether it's a story or not, it illustrates a principle. And it's the principle that's important. And that what it is that we are, again, trying to be prime creator. Trying to create a new reality, and that we're the prime creators of this new reality. There is no way to do that. But we believe we can find a way. And we have in several different ways. We believe that there is a power, a hidden power, that will, if we just find this hidden power, we can be prime creators and be the creators of a new, our own reality. Or we feel we can build it up gradually through a lot of collective effort and work and everybody on the same page. Or we believe that somehow it's just going to happen. Don't know how it happened. We'll never know how it happened. It's just going to happen. And so these three kind of beliefs in magic are always percolating. And they're essential. If we want to believe we can be prime creators, we have to have this magical beliefs. We have to have faith and belief in this. And much of this belief gets turned towards the belief that there's this hidden power. That the power's there. It's just we have to find a way to release it. We have to find a way to get it. We've got to get it. And so we believe there's this God. We believe that there's this source of power. We call it God. And this God has this power, but it just we hasn't released it to us yet. Okay, so now we go to the story of Jesus. Enter Jesus. Okay, perfect life, perfect love, reality. Really, Jesus was like reality, appearing as a body here. And we had the choice. We were given a choice. The whole thing to me sounds like a story, but it could also have actually taken place. Truth is stranger in fiction. But the way that it's written up, it perfectly illustrates the whole situation that we're in. Pilate said, choose who you want. You want Barabbas, this murderer? You want him to be set free, or you want to set free Jesus? He says, I find no fault with this man that you gave me, turned over to me. I find no fault with my wash my hands of this whole thing. But you know, I'll let you decide, the people here. I'll let you decide, what do you want? Okay, and the people said, no, we want to set the murderer free. That's what we want. And we want you to crucify this one. This blameless one, crucify that one. Okay, so the Romans supposedly carry this out. So, now, out of that crucifixion, now, there supposedly came a resurrection. Okay, but how has the basic belief systems developed around this story? It's developed that by sacrificing Jesus, somehow we pleased God so much that God was willing to save us from all our fear and misery and toil, that we somehow, this brought about a fundamental, complete change in God towards us. What it really means is those who believe this in crucifixion, crucifying Jesus caused a change in God's attitude towards, and all God's anger was gone, meaning God has decided to share the power with us of a new life. Okay, a new life. Meaning that this magical power we believe that this God has, that the choice of this world to choose a murderer over a perfectly blameless being, an innocent being, to choose a liar and deceiver over one who's the truth, tells the truth, and knows the truth, who is the truth, to choose death over life, that we feel that this pleased this God so much that this God now is going to release this saving power, grace to us, and make us prime creators, make this world reality, make it the new reality, the new creation, and that we own this world. It's the new reality, and we are the prime creators here now of this, in this new reality. Is it appeal to magic? 100%. That whole story is an appeal to magic, saying we're saved by the blood of Christ. In other words, the death of Christ saved us from God's wrath. Meaning that God was so pleased that we chose death and murder and lies and everything wicked over reality. What we really did is rejected reality. When we chose the murder of Barabbas, we rejected reality. Say, we don't want reality. No. We want death. We want, you know, murder. We want all this stuff. And then we believe that God was so pleased with this choice we made that God's gonna release this power to us. Obviously, what you have here is you have reality, the true God, the true prime creator, reality that we are trying to forsake. And we believe there's another God over here that has the power to enable us to forsake reality completely, to forsake the true God completely, and establish a new reality for us, enable us to be prime creators of a new reality. So we believe that by rejecting the true God, the God of life and truth and love, rejecting that and choosing destruction and death and suffering and misery and darkness and hatred and all this, by choosing that, that we, what we said was to this imaginary God that's supposed to have this power, we said, imaginary God with the power we want, look what we just did. We rejected completely the God of truth, life, and love, and reality, and being, and endlessness. We rejected that one. We said, no, we don't want that one. Get rid of that one. And we believe that this so pleased this imaginary God that has this imaginary power that magically is going to release it, this power to us. All you have to do is just believe it. This is going to happen for us now. It's very simple. Completely obvious. Completely obvious. This whole story. It's like, yeah, if we just completely reject the real God and in fact say, kill him. Crucify him, get rid of him. That's going to please this other imaginary God so much. This other imaginary God say, oh my gosh, now I see you really are my children. You know, you have one, you're children of illusion, you're children of non-being, of non-life, you're children of nothing. You've decided to completely reject reality. Oh, isn't that so wonderful? Now I see you really truly are my children, so I'm going to bestow upon you my gift that I was waiting to see which one you would choose. Now I see that you choose unreality, delusion. Now I'm going to release my full power to you. And so everybody's kind of still waiting for that full power to be released to them, you know. And that full power is supposed to be the power to enable us to be prime creators. Still waiting, aren't we? You see? Wow. It's completely obvious and simple, but nobody will say it. Because nobody wants to anger this God, you know, because we're hoping this imaginary God will release its power, you know. Release the power! I'm feeling the power, you know, this God, you know. There are not two gods. There isn't this imaginary God that's pleased by the sacrifice of reality. That's all a fantasy. It's all something we've made up. It's appeal to magic. We didn't get anything by sacrificing Jesus. Except that Jesus resurrected and said, look, you know, take a look at what you did. And real life cannot be killed. He said, I went through with it to show you that you chose to crucify me. I wanted to prove it to you. He didn't believe it. But now you got to believe it, don't you? Instead, a lot of people have said, no. Now we've succeeded because our God is so pleased that we decided to crucify truth and we're going to get this, we're going to be transformed. We're going to be the new creators, the new prime creators. No. What Jesus is saying is look, you wanted the proof, I gave you the proof. You didn't believe me. Here's the proof. I told you what you're doing. You're trying to reject reality. You're trying to create a new reality. You're trying to be the new prime creators. And you don't want anything to do with truth and life and reality. And you didn't believe me. Okay, so I came in. Here's a body. And here I am. And what did you do? See? I said, crucify him. Get rid of him. And now you're... happy as can be, saying that this is somehow saved you. But look, here I am again, resurrected, and you didn't really kill me. I just went through this so you could see what your intent was, so you could be confronted with your choice. That's the world, and then of course eventually Jesus left the world, was translated up into the higher, you know, the kingdom of heaven. And they said, where are you going? He said, this world here is not my place. This is the world of darkness, the world of delusion, world of death, murder, suffering, misery, lies, deceit, treachery. It's the world of forgetfulness of reality is what it is. It's the world of the appeal to magic. I'm not staying here. This is not my place. He said, but I'll come back and translate all those who want to dwell in reality, I'll translate them into the place I prepared for them. I'll come back when the Armageddon storm is about here. So, those are the facts. And I've been waiting my whole life for somebody to just say the obvious facts. Nobody's done it. Nobody's done it. So, you know, I can't keep waiting. Can't keep waiting around. It's just completely, totally obvious. That story, whether it actually was acted out on a literal fleshy level, or whether it was a story relating to the subtle dynamics of existence. You know, the principle is exactly the same. Truth is true, lies are lies. And truth and lies can't both be true. When we choose a lie, we have to reject the truth. Okay, and in that story, humanity rejected the truth and felt, thought, believed, had faith in believing that this rejection of truth would lead to their salvation, because then that would so impress this magical God that they believe in, that this magical God would be so impressed and would just love that rejection so much that they would feel this new love, you know, love for rejecting reality, and that this is somehow going to transform us. We want to be loved for rejecting love. That's basically what we're trying to do. We want a new love to come, a new love. And something that loves us for turning away from love. Something that we want a new reality, something that is becomes real from rejecting reality. We want a new truth, something that a truth that comes true from rejecting truth. You know, this is all belief in magic. As we see this storm on the horizon coming in with all this lightning, and we're thinking, oh, here comes our salvation. You know, this is coming in answer to our prayers, in answer to our rejection of truth and love and reality. Here it comes, here it comes. It's delusional. We think it's bringing in a new love, a new truth, a new reality, a new life based on the rejection of truth and life and love and reality. This is magic, a belief in magic. It's self-destructive. It's like believing if we destroy ourselves, we will get a new life. If we destroy life, we get a new life. Not true. Not true. It's 100% delusional. We're transfixed in this world because the 99.999% of the world is simply believing in magic, that somehow magic will work for them. That somehow the rejection of reality will result in them receiving a new reality that were there, the prime creators of it. Not true. All that happens is you experience all this loss. You're thinking that the more loss you experience, the better off you are, because that's getting you closer to receiving everything. As if you lose everything, as if turning your back on everything is going to result in you getting more than everything. As if turning your back on truth is going to result in you having something greater than truth. As if turning your back on love is going to get result in something greater than love. If turning your back on life is resulting in something greater than life. So everyone is very eager to try to lose everything, lose it all. And here comes this Armageddon storm, and they think, ah, finally, the means to really lose it all is almost here now. And so they're waiting for it, you know, waiting in their seats, waiting for the movie to start. And we say, no, this is insanity. You're not going to get anything. You're just going to get loss and misery and suffering and shock and pain and horror and all this, you know, dreadful stuff. And it's not going to result in anything. There is no imaginary God. There's no God of our imagination. Our imagination cannot create God. It creates a fantasy of God. It creates an expectation. Creates a belief, creates a faith in an imaginary God that is greater than God, has some greater power than God, but doesn't make it true. just our imagination running away with us. And so our imagination is transfixing us in our seats as this storm approaches. It's our pride, our spiritual pride, saying, yes, we can, transfixing us. The real mantra should be, no, we can't, as far as two sides, no, we can't, yes, we can. No, we cannot create a God. We cannot be greater than reality. We cannot transcend reality. No, we cannot. No, we cannot. But can we give up that effort? Yes, we can. Yes, we can. So that's the real yes we can, is we can give up our insane efforts to, through total loss, receive more than everything. Through trying to reject all reality, reject reality. And reality is one, so your rejection is all of it. You have to reject endlessness. Has to reject, you know, all of reality. By doing that, we think, we believe we'll get more than that, more than that. But we have to show our loyalty to the more than that, okay? That is it. It's a loyalty question. It's like the people in Jesus' time that felt they had to show the loyalty to this imaginary God of our imagination. And only by rejecting Jesus, rejecting truth and life and love, rejecting it, that way we proved our loyalty. That's the whole thing about sacrifices, proving our loyalty, right? By being willing to give up our lives, proving that, hey, look, giving up life, giving up truth, giving up all that, that we've proved our loyalty. And then only by doing that we receive then the rewards of proof of loyalty. That we think this imaginary God is holding back, because it's not sure that we're entirely loyal. Because within us, we're not entirely loyal. Because within us is truth and life and love and reality and endlessness and delight, endless delight and safety and freedom. We're still within that. We didn't separate from it. So it's still there, even though we're in a dream of forgetfulness. So we project that out. And we think, this imaginary God still doesn't trust us. This imaginary God feels like we're wishy-washy and we're not 100% loyal. So what can we do to prove we're 100% loyal? And that's what we're thinking. If we just can prove it to this God, we're 100% loyal, then we're going to get more than everything. And it'll be just unbelievably great. So we keep conjuring up some way to prove this. Which is why you have this little party. We got this Armageddon storm headed our way, which we have conjured up, imagined up. All existence is just a play of our imagination. And we expect that this is going to be the final proof, because we're going to lose everything. We've got a lot to lose, don't we? And we build up stuff simply so that we can then lose a lot. And by losing a lot, we think we give a lot of proof of loyalty to this imaginary God who's going to then give us, bestow this, share this power with us that this imaginary God has to be greater than reality. So first we have to construct a lot of stuff to lose, and then the storm comes and we lose it all, and then we believe we're going to get the reward. But what happens? Nothing. And then we have to spin it. And we have to say, well, this just almost got there, but this just sets up the final loss. We just have to build up an even greater scenario and lose all of that, and then that will be the final loss. And that is simply existence. That's the dream, because it never works. So we always say, you know, one drink, just one more, and then another. Put the bottle on the table. Let it stay there till I'm not able. And I'll have just one drink, and then another. That's it. You know, we always think this drink is the last one, but this drink doesn't quite do it for us. So we pour another. Let it stay there till I'm not able to see your face everywhere I go. Yeah. See, so every time we experience a loss, we keep thinking, I hope this is it. I hope this is it. I hope this is it. I hope this proves my loyalty. And then the power doesn't arrive, because of course there is no such power, so of course it doesn't arrive. And we then say, gosh, I guess I didn't prove it. I guess I gotta do it one more time, just one more. And the ego says, yeah, just one more. One more is gonna do it for sure. And then you do that, and again, it doesn't work. And then you say, wow, that didn't work. I say, well, almost. One more is gonna do it, though. Never does it, because there is no such imaginary God. There is no such imaginary power. And, we just get, eventually we get tired of getting pummeled, you know, by building up all this stuff and then losing it all. We get tired of that. He says, what's going on here? Existence is kind of crazy, isn't it? It's really crazy. We know it's kind of crazy. We don't really understand it. That's just why I'm explaining it here, because I do understand it. It's simply that this is what it is. It's loss. Trying to prove our loyalty. You know, we build everything up, and then we wait, and say, okay, is God pleased with our, you know, spending all our time building up this power? But there's no power there. And then the loss, we say, okay, wow, maybe we're going to have to lose it all to show our loyalty. It's a mishmash. Existence is a mishmash. There are efforts to simply try and build up and maintain flesh-based civilization and life, and believe that somehow by just developing continuously that it will develop into the power. And there are other scenarios that are being played out where you're focused on loss, that's the way. So this world right now is focused on loss. Armageddon Storm is coming, and we're trying to prove our loyalty through going through severe loss, and then still saying, God, I still love you. Look, I went through all this loss, and I'm still loyal to you. And didn't I prove my loyalty? And we expect then God to smile and say, yes, you finally proved it. Here is this power you've been longing to have, my children. That's the fantasy. It's a fantasy. There's no truth to it whatsoever. And it really is that simple. And there are those, the wanderers, who think they're just going to stumble upon the power somehow, just by kind of aimlessly wandering around, you know, and not into anything, just wander. Someday I'm just going to stumble upon it, and I'll get it that way. And then there are those who think they're going to get it through process of development. Let's keep learning, keep developing, keep studying. Somehow we'll discover the God power. You know, they discovered the God particle. The next thing they think they'll discover is the God power. And we're almost found the power of God to empower us. We can be empowered. We're trying to be empowered. And all the while, forgetting all about reality. The fact is that we have everything, already have everything. We already are completely empowered to experience everything endlessly. Complete safety, complete freedom. We're already empowered for all that. We already are life and truth and love and reality and pure experiencing of essence. And we're rejecting that all and trying to have more. Greater than that. I'm going to get a drink of water. Let's take a little break here. We're at the 49 minute mark. Let's take a break. Just 1 second here. Be right back. All right. Very great. This is the kind of feistiness you need. so I'm still able to deliver it. Wasn't easy, I tell you that. Phew. There's a feisty car right there. Feisty means you can't keep buying into the narrative. That's insane. It's an insane narrative. However you slice the pie of loss is an insane narrative. That by losing all, somehow we're going to gain all. It's not true. By remembering what we are, we gain all. In this sense, by letting go of this insane effort to lose everything, we gain everything. In other words, by letting go of this appeal to magic existence, we gain everything. So in that sense, by losing everything, we gain everything. By losing the dream, by waking up from the dream, we remember reality. So in that sense, the saying is true. But in the sense of experiencing loss in the dream, and expecting that to translate into greater than everything, that it's a delusion. It's not going to happen. And yet everybody here is just waiting, you know, they're just happy for the loss to come. You know, it's amazing. The loss is coming and everyone is just hunkering down, staying put, and having their, getting their snacks ready. Getting their popcorn ready. Because they don't have a clue. And listening to these videos, you should at least have a clue now. You should at least feel that I have a clue. And I'm not lying down for this situation at all. It's literally a magic show. Appeal to magic. An appeal to wishful thinking. We wish that there was a power that would make us greater in reality. So therefore, we believe it must be there. We must believe that there must be a way to get it. We have to prove we're loyal. We have to prove that we've truly turned our back on reality. How do we do that? Death. That's how we do it. Loss. That includes death. Loss, bigger picture, loss of everything. Loss of, try to lose as much as possible. Thinking that gives as much evidence as possible of our loyalty that we've turned our back on reality. Because why? In reality, it's impossible to lose anything. There's no such thing as loss in reality. So if we want to try and prove to some imaginary god, some different god, that we've turned our back on reality, the best way to do it is loss. And we say, hey, look, I don't believe in reality anymore. I believe in loss. Look at my death. Look at I'm losing everything here. I've lost everything. I've lost my planet even. I've lost my life. Everyone's lost their lives. Obviously, I don't believe in reality anymore because reality, there's no loss. So we try to prove our loyalty to another god by loss, through loss. That's how we do it. So now you know. Now you know the secret. Now you know why existence is the way that it is. It's all about trying to prove our loyalty. It's like, God, we say, God, when I die, I know I'm going to go to heaven because I've proved I'm willing to die for you. And, of course, in reality, there is no death. God didn't create death. Prime Creator did not create death. There's no loss. So this appeal can't possibly be to the Prime Creator. Can't possibly be to reality. Cannot possibly be. So when we die, what are we appealing to? We're appealing to another imaginary God that we believe can give us what we want. That's it. But most of us here don't want to let go of this, what we call a great opportunity. thinking that, wow, we know that the opportunity for to prove our loyalty to law, to loss, to this, to rejecting reality, to prove our, that we're loyal to becoming greater than reality. Here's this great opportunity coming up, and people don't want to squander this great opportunity. That's why it's hard to run in the opposite direction. We think we're running away from opportunity. We really believe it. We don't entirely believe it, but we're surrounded in an environment, in a world culture that totally believes it. So it's hard to break free of that inertia. It's hard to decide, you know, to run away from the storm. Difficult. How do you go against the crowd, against the peer pressure? So that's the struggle. We can be entirely clear about this and yet still succumb to the peer pressure. You know, like if you know something's wrong, you know breaking into that house is wrong, but if your peers want to do it and say, yeah, let's all do it together, and the peer pressure gets the people to do stuff they wouldn't ordinarily do at all, and they know it was wrong at the time. They just didn't want to feel like they were going to be ostracized and you know, be a snitch maybe, etc. It's awful. Peer pressure is awful. Terrible. That's why I don't like hanging out in groups. Because that's where you get the peer pressure. It's awful. Only way I feel I can avoid the pressure is just being by myself and not hanging out in groups. Because, you know, where can you find a group of people who are truly oriented towards truth? I haven't seen it. Is there a group of is there a group of beings in this world who perfectly understand truth and are not the slightest bit frightened to speak it and point out what existence really is? I've never come across it. Never come across it. The best you get is some teachers here and there who know, but you know, you don't come across a group. The group is going to. It's hard to turn your back when you've set up a vast scenario of loss, as we have done. It's hard to walk away from that. Walk away from what seems to be opportunity to transcend. Seems to be transcend. But what are we trying to transcend? We're trying to transcend reality. Can't do it. And therefore, we will find ourselves simply building up another scenario of so-called magical opportunity. It goes on and on. It goes on and on and on. How do you break free of the cycles of existence when it goes on and on and on? By realizing it goes on and on and on. By realizing we're trying to appeal to nothing. By realizing there is no power to transform us, make us greater than reality. That loss is appealing to nothing. Gets us nowhere. Only by realizing this do we finally get free of these cycles. Only by realizing this, by seeing it, by admitting it, saying, yeah, I see it. I know it's true. This is true. By confessing this is true. This is repentance. This is repentance. You're called to repentance, meaning to confess. Yeah, I mean, I've lost. Will never work. It's never had the slightest effect ever. And I've just been engaged in really doing nothing at all. Only then do you not get engaged in building up another scenario of loss. Only then do you not go through with a loss scenario. Only then do you decide to walk away from fake opportunity, false hope, and empty opportunity. What seems to be opportunity is just a mirage. Just a mirage. There's no opportunity there for us to receive any power over reality. There's no power over reality. Reality is what it is and will always be what it is, and that's all that there is. And we can't create something separate from it. It's impossible. We can't come up with new rules. New reality on new rules. No, there's only identity. We can't create a separate identity. The rules of God are inviolate. You cannot change them. Only when we realize this do we then decide we don't need to engage in any more loss scenarios. We don't need to experience loss, and we don't need to build up another loss scenario. Now, it's true that in a loss scenario that's been set up, that's going to be lost. So what you need is you need to, as I've said in other videos, experience unconditional love. Turn to that, which cannot be lost, And it's also, it's possible to be translated into another scenario, a loss-free scenario, where we don't feel, of course, like if this, for instance, if a world is going to be wiped out, and you're still in the world, you know, you'll lose your house, you'll lose your possessions, you'll lose everything here, of course. Probably you lose your life too. Now, you don't have to, if you've already repented and now you're experiencing unconditional love, then you won't experience loss at all. Because you've already lost loss. You've set loss down. Because really everything you see in this world is loss. Potential loss. It will be lost. When? Okay, is the only question. So you really don't have anything. You're not holding anything except for loss. You're holding loss. It's like you're holding a handful of sand and it's slipping through your fingers and you're carrying it around and you know you're losing. You're losing at all times. You're experiencing loss and loss, and you're going to lose it all. It's going to slip through your fingers entirely. So we already, this world is nothing but loss. So it's really nothing. And so we can exchange this world for something that cannot be lost. And when we do that, even if the world is lost, we won't feel like we've lost anything. Muji said, die now so you don't have to die later, is a way to put it. Repent now. Repent. Okay. Give up loss. Voluntarily is different than trying to experience loss. You're not trying to experience it. You're trying to set it down so you don't experience it. It's different. It's not like when you set loss down, you experience loss, because you're doing it in a at the level of choice and will and spirit and clarity, and you realize that when you set loss down, you'll experience the overlay of unconditional love, and loss will vanish. You won't feel any loss. If you set the feeling of loss down, it's not that you'll feel loss anymore. You'll feel no loss at all. Some people call it nothing, no thing, no thingness, emptiness, or whatever. It's the same. Because if you don't have any loss, anything that can be lost, how can you experience loss? You cannot. You can't say, well, I'm experiencing the loss of loss. I mean, you can do that. And if you're still have the belief that loss is going to bring you something, then that would feel like total loss. So you cannot repent intellectually or conceptually just because you want to impress somebody or anything like that. No, it's impossible. Because literally, if you're still holding on to believe that loss can give you what you want, then the loss of loss will seem to be absolutely the worst thing possible. Just be annihilation for you. I mean, loss of all opportunity, and it would just be terrible. So repentance comes from wisdom, that you see that losing loss is not a loss, because it never could give you anything in the first place. Never could give you anything. So where's the loss? There isn't any. But getting to this point is the whole point of satsang, is the whole point of spiritual path. That's what the teachers are trying to bring us to, is doing just that, realizing that realization that the loss of loss is not loss. And we struggle with that because we're so completely addicted to believing that loss can bring us what we want. It's really tough for us to see it otherwise than that. Because otherwise we have to admit we've been wasting our time. eons. We've been wasting our time from the very beginning of existence, just wasting our time, which is true. It's all we've done. We haven't done anything. And there again, we think that we're going to experience this devastation like we've been wasting our time. But there's no devastation in reality. There's no loss in reality. So when you set loss down, what else can you experience except for unconditional love, except for lack of loss? No loss. There's no devastation to be experienced, but that's what we're all afraid of. That if we admit that we've simply wasted our time, that we're going to feel this horrible feeling. It's not really there. It's not there. Cannot be there. What could give us that horrible feeling? Only loss of opportunity, right? And there was no opportunity, and reality's always been with us, exactly the same as always. So, infinite opportunity still there. So when we give up no opportunity, what is there except for infinite opportunity? So how can we feel devastated? We cannot. But from the side that we're looking at it, from our perspective of looking at it from standpoint of what we're used to, it seems plausible that we would experience just absolute devastation of just maybe completely depressed, beyond depressed, like, oh my gosh, I never did anything. I wasted my time. I could have been truly experiencing this whole time, experiencing in no loss at all, in perfect freedom, and in an infinite delight. I could have been doing this all the time. Well, the fact is, we have been. We just not haven't been aware of it. But there's no space to feel loss or depression there, because the delight is there. So it's either we experience loss or delight. And if you set loss down, you have to experience delight. There's no two ways about it. And you know, I'm looking at it from the standpoint of struggle and resistance and reluctance, etc. Looking at it from this standpoint of how does it look from this standpoint? The only other standpoint is delight. That's it. There isn't any other standpoint. So a teacher is either in this bliss and delight, or they're looking at it from the standpoint of what seems to be so frightening, you know. I'm looking at it from that standpoint at this point, but I may shift. I may set the loss down and shift into delight, because that's the only two options there are. Unconditional love is just this, it's just this bliss. And we can shift in that at any time, because there isn't anything else to shift into. We either stick with loss or experience unconditional love. That's it. There isn't anything else we can experience. But we keep thinking that we can experience the loss of unconditional love because somehow we didn't please God, because we've been trying to create a new God and all this stuff. No, the laws of reality are inviolate. They're still, can't change them. So God cannot punish us in any way. We're unpunishable. We are literally unpunishable. The laws of God cannot punish at all, cannot deprive at all. We're undeprivable. We cannot be deprived. We cannot be punished. We cannot be harmed. We cannot be rejected. Reality is all, has all, everything, has everything, and it's endless, and it's perfectly freedom to experience everything, and always. And the laws of reality cannot be changed, so there cannot be any harm for us. There cannot be any punishment for us. There cannot be any anger towards us. There cannot be any deprivation. None of that is possible. Totally impossible. So even though we plausibly think that, wow, we've been trying to destroy reality, so reality is, you know, must get back at us, or we're going to feel regret or something. Cannot. There's no regret in reality. No punishment, no regret. Nothing but delight. That's all we can experience. So in truth, it's either stick with loss and see loss as an opportunity, or experience endless delight. That's the only two possibilities, as Jesus puts it, either experience love or fear. I tend to, you know, I use my own terminology for that. I say either experience the either believe that loss has some opportunity for you, or you experience endless delight. One or the other. It can't be both, because there's no loss and endless delight, and there's no endless delight and loss. Two are mutually exclusive. So we're right there. And there is this freak out step that we think, you know, wow, I could really lose everything. I could lose the opportunity that loss gives me, and then I could also lose reality, because reality will say, I don't want you. You believed in loss for so long. I've forgotten all about you. I don't know you. You know, all this kind of talk. This talk, we've been terrorized by this talk of like hell, eternal damnation, and I don't know you, I'm going to reject you, turn your back. It's all nonsense. It's all total nonsense. Reality is literally incapable of being anything other than what it is. So there is nothing that we can ever do that can change reality at all. So reality is exactly the same as it's always been, and will always be exactly that way. The laws of the Prime Creator are exactly the way they have always been and will always be. And there is no change. We cannot change it. Even if we turn our back on it, you know, for eons and eons and eons, and we can't change it. It doesn't change it in the slightest bit. We are still 100% welcome there, beyond welcome. We are there. We can't be harmed. We can't be dispossessed. We can't be re-educated. We can't be, you know, ill-treated. We can't suffer any loss, any harm, any vulnerability, any feeling other than perfect freedom, perfect safety, perfect delight, endlessly. That's it. That's all that there is in reality. That's what reality provides. And we can't have less than that. We cannot have less than that. It's impossible. And so we're thinking, you know, hey, we don't want to give up loyalty to loss entirely. So can't we have a little bit of bliss and still, you know, maybe hang in there with loss and get some good stuff too? We think maybe we can have both, have our cake and eat it too. No, because reality can only give endless delight, pure delight, pure delight. There can't be any loss. Reality can't give us the experience of loss. Cannot. As long as we think loss can give us something we want, we'll continue to experience loss. And we'll experience, we'll feel some kind of severe tension in us. Tension of thinking that we can oscillate between the two. The belief in trying to blend the two is to oscillate, you know, choose reality and then jump back and choose loss, choose reality, choose loss, back and forth. And this creates sort of a feeling that we need to be very quick, so that we think if we oscillate fast enough, it will seem like we're experiencing both at the same time, that they've mixed together. They haven't mixed together. They have not mixed together. So the ambiguity there of let's have both, let's have our cake and eat it too. Can't do it. So eventually we need to arrive at the point where we realize that and just, okay, we just set loss down all together. That's it. That's all the teachers tell us we have to do. That's it. There isn't any goal other than that. There's only one goal. Set it all down. And don't try to oscillate. You know, we can oscillate. Reality doesn't prevent us from oscillating, but blending cannot. Reality cannot provide the experience of loss for us. So either it's 100% loss or 100% no loss. So we have to be 100%er. We're all trying to be 50%ers. That's not possible. It's not possible. So as we sit there and see this Armageddon storm approaching, we're thinking, well, maybe I can be a 50%er, maybe I can get something from loss, and I can also avoid the worst of the loss, and, you know, play it that way. Oh boy, that creates a tension in us. And the relief only will come when we set down loss, set it down. Don't pick it up again. Relief will come when we set it down, but if we pick it up again, then the relief is gone. So we need to, in the face of this coming storm, we need to be able to continue to speak the truth. It's getting difficult. It is not easy. It's getting very difficult, which is why it's so important to set loss down, realize that you're always going to be 100%er. Everyone's 100%er. They're deluding themselves by thinking they're not. They are. Either 100% belief in loss or 100% endless delight. And it is possible to deconstruct it a little more. It is possible. I'm not going to try to do that right now. Just want to convey the intensity is still there, and the necessity to see it 100%. Got to be 100%ers. Everyone is. That absolute, get to feel that absolute taste of absolute, this way or that way. That is, if you feel the taste of that, you're right there. You're right there. If you can say for just a moment, say, yeah, I see it. I can see that. You're right there. You're right there. Not far of it all. Very close, if you can see that. Because most will say, no, I don't even want to look at that. I want to blend. I want to blend the two. Which is just a delaying tactic. Which is just waiting until they can figure out some way for loss to work perfectly, you know. They say, well, we can't make loss work quite yet, so maybe we need to blend a little bit of delight with the loss. Until we can have total loss and therefore total transformation and all that kind of stuff. So that's it. And that's have to keep this intensity going. Have to keep it going every day. Because every day we're getting clobbered. The storm is getting closer. You know, when you feel an approaching storm, you can feel it. So it's scary. Like if a hurricane's coming in, tornado, whatever. You can feel the pressure shifting, right? Absolutely. Right now there's a high pressure system here in the Bay Area. It's beautiful, very calm. But, you know, when the pressure systems shift, then you get this intense bands of wind. Extreme wind, you know, becomes very windy. And you realize, whoa. The climate, the shift in the weather is coming. It is coming. You know it. And you can feel, here comes the cold, here comes the rain, here comes the change. So we know, here comes the change. Cultural weather, you know, culture has a weather also. And we realize, here comes the change. The change is coming. It's coming. These events are like severe wind as the pressure systems change. And it's you feel that and you say, whoa, I don't have very long to make up my mind here. Because before we know it, the loss is going to be upon us. And we will have indulged in that opportunity, which brings us nothing. And having indulged in it, we're going to expect a result. And expecting a result, we don't get it. What do? We reinvest in building up another scenario. So I say another cycle. When you indulge in loss, you expect a payoff. And if you don't get it right away, then you will say, well, I need to do something to extract this payoff that should be coming to me. And it's a doubling down. We double down and build up another loss scenario. It's really amazing, but we double down. So it's very important not to experience the loss that's coming, because we'll end up doubling down. We can hardly resist that. It'll become very difficult to not say, wait a minute, I went through all this loss, I deserve the payoff, and I'm not getting it. Wait a minute, I need to make sure that I get it. So I need to really put the screws to whatever is not delivering this, and I need to engage maybe and prove it even more. And you think, well, I must be really close, so I'm really going to have even a more intense loss scenario. Of course, you're going to look back on the previous one and say, if that didn't work, that means I must have to build up something even more intense loss. And you will. The universe gives you endless opportunities to build up loss scenarios. Whatever you want to lose, you can lose it. Whatever. You want to lose your life, you know, lose your body life, of course you can lose it. You want to lose your world, you can lose a world. You want to lose a galaxy, you can lose a galaxy. You want to even lose the whole universe, you can even lose that. You can lose anything here. You can feel lost here. Whatever, it just supports loss of all types, all varieties. And you will do that, you'll double down. So, very important, don't go with the loss scenario here that's going to take place. Turn your back on it so you don't double down. The very least you do is you won't double down, okay? Which is a huge, huge thing. And your clarity will grow. When you don't double down, your clarity will say, oh, wait a minute. And it's very easy to catch the thread of truth. Very easy. It's not always easy to hold on to it. But it's very easy to catch the thread of it. And once you catch it, you say, whoa, wait a minute, I know it's here somewhere. And then you'll do inquiry. Say, I need to grab hold of that thread again. You know it's here. All right, very great. That's enough for this video. Maybe I'll do another one a little later, depending how I feel. Okay. That's it for this one.